Hi guys, welcome back. I'm Ian Laspina. Today we're going to talk about the Met Harness. Hey guys, welcome back. So today we're going to take a look at one of the most iconic suits of armor in the world. The circa 1400 Armor for Man at the Metropolitan Museum of Art with the red velvet covered cuirass. It's probably one of the most easily recognizable suits of armor in the world, and it's probably been one of the most highly influential suits of armor in the entire world in the reenactor sphere. Unfortunately, it is again a compromised suit of armor as far as its historical construction goes, so copying it is something that you would want to do with extreme caution. To understand what's wrong with the Met cuirass, we have to go back to the discovery of its constituent components at Chalkis. The Chalkis hoard comes from from Chalkis, Chalcis, Chalkida, whatever you want to call it. It is a town on the Greek island of Euboea, and this location served as a military fortress going all the way back to ancient Greece. In the Middle Ages, through the 14th and 15th century, it was a Venetian military fortress that eventually fell to a siege by the Ottoman Empire in the late 15th century. In the 1840s, a large cache of the Venetian medieval 14th and 15th century armors were discovered in the ruins of the Chalkis fortress. This is where we get things like the Venetian great bassinets, a significant number of helmets and limb armor from this time, and a large number of constituent plates for early Brigandine late coat of plate style covered torso protections. A significant portion of this armor wound up in the private collection of Dr. Bashford Dean. Bashford Dean was an early, late 19th century, early 20th century scientist and armor historian. He was professionally a paleoichthyologist, but he was also a private collector of arms and armor, and he had amassed a very large and very important collection of historical arms and armor. Eventually, as time went on, his kind of passion shifted more primarily toward arms and armor, and he ended up founding the Arms and Armor Gallery, the Arms and Armor Department at the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York. He was the honorary curator there and then eventually became the permanent curator of arms and armor. After his death, his private collection of arms and armor became what was the foundational basis for the permanent collection at the Met. Now, Bashford Dean really wanted to be able to display a circa 1400 suit of armor. And the problem is no complete suit of armor from that era exists. So not letting that stop him, he kind of created one from the components that he had in his collection. Most of the components that we see on the display come from the Chalkis hoard, with the exception of the bassinet. While the bassinet is of the right era, it just happens to not be from the Chalkis hoard, so it's not associated with the other components, but it gives the right aesthetic for the era. There are a lot of restorations done on the armor. A lot of the brass edging and things like that are 20th century restorations. They're not original. Some of the brass decoration is original, so they were made to match. But there are also some other kind of questionable things like the spodlers, the protection for the shoulders. The particular design, how Dean decided to arrive at that design is kind of odd. There are no other types of shoulder protection that look like that. It's just kind of a weird design. So when he was cobbling things out of his components, where he decided to come up with that, I don't know. So the real problem with this armor is in the cuirass. It's probably the most visually striking part of the armor, but it's also the most heavily compromised part of the armor. It's also, unfortunately, the most copied part of the armor, and you can immediately tell when somebody copied this cuirass because it is unique in that it has a completely non-functional fold. So starting from the outside, we see the bright red velvet covering. Is there anything wrong with that? Well, we know it's a 20th century restoration, but we also know that in period, Covered armors were covered in things like bright colored velvets. We see that in inventories. We see that on original surviving pieces that still have the original fabric. Even a number of the Chalkis Horde plates still have fragmentary pieces of layers of fabric still adhered to the surviving armors. So it gives the proper aesthetic, but it's just not an original piece of fabric. The real problem lies in the construction, though. So what was done was Bashford Dean basically had this Lego set of unrelated pieces of Brigandine armors from the Chalkis Horde, and in his mind's eye, wanting to create something that would be visually representative of a covered cuirass of this era, he started taking components that looked like they could kind of go together and created what you see here. The real problem with this, though, is in the fald, the way that he designed the fald. The fald is the skirt that goes around the hips and the abdomen and the lower back that connects to the bottom of the breastplate and the back plates. The way that he designed it is they are vertically hanging rectangular pieces of plate, and they go all the way around, and you can see that they're essentially connected to each other by virtue of being connected to the shell and then buckled at the sides and in the front. I don't know if there's a buckle in the back or not. But what that does is it makes it very immobile. It cannot collapse. As you lean forward, those plates have nowhere to go. They're going to press into you. They're going to be unable to articulate forward because they're buckled to the pieces on the back. So it's going to make for a very immobile armor. And when we look at real falds from that particular era, what we invariably see in artwork and in survivals is hooped horizontal lames that either overlap or underlap, depending on which particular ones you're looking at. But invariably, they're all these horizontal hoops. And what that does is it allows the fald to collapse over itself to permit the kind of motion that you need in order to move, in order to sit down on a horse and things like that. Even on medieval saddles, where equitation is very upright in the saddle and you're almost kind of standing in the saddle, you do need the fald to be able to collapse to a certain degree in order to comfortably get into that position, and it just cannot happen with a fald like this. So when we look at something like my reproduction here, you can see that the way that the fald is designed, as you lean forward, it can collapse over itself. As you lean to the side, the same thing happens. If you're sitting down, the entire thing can compress under its own weight. And it's articulated on leathers in the back. That's what permits that motion. In historical examples, we see leather articulation like that. We also see things like sliding rivets or a combination of sliding rivets and leathers. How it's articulated is kind of irrelevant to this discussion. What's important is that collapsing motion is essential to a functional fald, in the sense that it will actually work on somebody who needs to fight in it, who needs to fight on foot or on horseback. Some people may look at it and say, like, well, what about tassets? Tassets hang vertically. Yes, they do, but tassets can also move independently of one another. And unfortunately here, they're all attached to form the skirt, and they can't because they're all basically connected to each other. So he was going for a circa 1400 fald, not later 15th century tassets, and he ended up creating something that was non-functional. Unfortunately, this hasn't stopped a lot of people from copying this design. And you can still today go to armorer's websites and see basically direct copies of this style of fald on what they call corazinas. And you know that they're copying this, or even worse, they're copying other copies, because this is the only style of fald like this that's in existence in the world, with the exception of one other piece of a Brigandine armor that was also assembled by Bashford Dean around the same time as this one. So if you are interested in late 14th century covered armors, Hooped fold is the historical answer, not these vertical rectangular plates. Vertical rectangular plates is non-functional. Hooped fold is functional. It's supported by the historical evidence. Don't copy compromised armor. So I hope you guys enjoyed the video. Thanks for watching. If you like the video, please click that like button down below. Subscribe if you haven't already for more videos and share with your friends. Thank you very much to the patrons on Patreon who have decided to help support the channel. I'm very appreciative. And until next time, thank you for watching. Bye.